Hey, everybody. There's a lot of people joining in here all at once, so it'll take a second to populate. We've never actually done a Zoom call with this many people, so we'll see what happens.
How's everybody doing?
Good. Awesome. How's yourself?
Good. Glad to see you. See you in person.
Great. We'll see you all.
We're just letting people populate here.
Can people hear me?
Yep.
Yep. There we go. That works much better.
All right.
Where did you find an ice cave in August?
I found it deep in the Himalayas.
Are you sure you didn't find it deep in Egypt?
Yeah, well, it could be. That's how fortune and glory works. We don't have a lot specifically on the agenda. We were looking at the different stuff to set up for events for our Gen Con Online, or Johnline, as I just tried to make it. And we said, you know, what if we took one of these events, like, you know, this originally was going to be a live stream where we show off, here's progress on phase three stuff and whatever, but we thought, what if we actually did, I mean, this is a community. This is our peeps. This is our Kickstarter community for Forbidden Fortress. And we thought, what if we actually did it as a Zoom call so it's interactive? And so a small portion of this is basically going to be us talking and showing progress and stuff like that. And then the bigger portion is going to be just a chance for us to hang out with you guys and, you know, find out how things went. I mean, a lot of people probably were in the original Shadows of Brimstone Kickstarter, and then did the Forbidden Fortress one, and we tried to make a lot of improvements, and this is a chance where we could kind of get feedback about it before we do the setup of, you know, how we're packing the next Kickstarter, the Brimstone Adventures and stuff like that. So we'd love to get feedback, we'd love to hear from you guys, we'd love to share information about how you organize your games, or how you, you know, where you go to meet other players and get together and play online or out in different communities. You know, all of that good stuff, basically kind of a meetup where we can hang out. That's also why it's a little less formal. You'll see, I'm just chilling in my ice cave. Jason's there in front of his, game bookshelf with a Deep Space Nine back there, I think.
Are you guys in Washington State?
Yes.
Yes, we are.
Yeah, we're just north of Seattle. Okay.
Yeah, I was wondering if you guys hadn't even gone anywhere.
No. It's we run the Gen Con Online events in East Coast time, but only because Gen Con's normally in Indiana, they basically run it on a clock of Indiana time, East Coast time. And so we followed suit. We're like, well, let's you know, keep with the hours that everybody's doing different Gen Con events. But other than that, honestly, our stuff seems to be fairly separate from Gen Con. I mean, when we were looking at it, we're like, okay, so like we should run our events through the Gen Con Online thing. And then the more we read about it, it's like, this doesn't seem like it's really for businesses and vendors and exhibitors to do events. This seems more like it's for individual gamers to run events. And so,
well, the other thing is that they wanted all of the events run through Gen Con Online to be ticketed, which means that there has to be a cost.
Yeah, and they had a base price of $2. And which, that's not a lot, but we're not into charging for people to play demos of our games or game sessions, you know?
Yeah, we wanted to make it as accessible as possible to everybody around the world, in fact. And it looks like we have some faces here from around the world. Anybody here from Australia?
Yeah.
Yeah, mate.
Absolutely. wonderful Melbourne right now.
It just says Brian. Is that Brian Aslan?
Yeah.
Hey, yeah. Good to see you.
What time is it in Australia?
I'm in contact with Adrian.
Yeah, there's
a lining of the pandemic, just so I get to see you guys.
Yeah, I see the Sheriff of Brimstone there.
Yeah. Where's the bad?
Hello.
Yeah, he should be here. You would think.
Brian has made the best character dashboards in the history of the game.
Yeah.
Out of your character dashboards, yeah.
That's awesome. That's are what they, makes are they the like best. Plastic, like 3D print dashboards?
No. I like the art, and it just seemed like a shame that we got this beautiful artwork and we don't get to use it after level one, basically, because you're changing your stats and putting little tokens on.
No camera.
Okay, except they could get knocked off, or how do you store that? So changed them into a larger character sheet that's got slots for a lot more things, and it's got a backside on it that you can write your items down on. It doesn't do everything, but it was basically, if you're going to pack up and then come back to a character 6 months later, everything you need can be written on it. That was my idea, was, you know, if you get two groups, you can use the sheet to do both groups and not take characters cards away from the other group's experience.
Yeah. So you
repack the cards, play the other group, and when you want to go back to first group, it's all there. They're up on the group, I think. Yeah.
Well, that's great. Yeah. I mean, this is one of the things that we really love seeing is everybody putting, you know, putting their creativity toward different storage solutions and different, like the character sheet solutions, different 3D tokens and tricking out their set and different ways of labeling their map tiles and stuff like that. It's just a lot of fun.
I use those sheets too.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Yeah, they're really good. Expensive to print at Office Max in color, but yeah.
Oh, very cool.
You do have a copy. I would have sent the original lot we did, and then I've forgotten his name already, but the guy who updated him with the newer stuff, he would have
emailed that through
or sent a link. Yeah.
Jens, I can't pronounce the names. I'm terrible at German, but Jens Rickles picked up and made them for Fofo and improved them just a little bit, but the original was just so great because it was all the original art. It was really just like the starter dashboards and then just expanded with fillable field. You know, you just write on them. I laminate them.
Lamination.
Yep.
Mm. Oh, that's cool. And then you could do dry erase markers or something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I had all the tokens on. So.
I just update my character sheets on my computer and print them out every time I need them.
Mm. Somebody's showing off his collection over in the corner.
Yeah, I can see that. It's unfurling. The unveiling has begun. I like
we,
that.
We,
it's all covered in plastic.
We have a question we wanted to ask.
Sure.
The question was, we were, you know, backers of the original Kickstarter, and, you know, we got the original Resin Heroes from the
like
original,
the
like the
stuff.
Gambler and Jargo Native from the original cast.
Right.
Well, we know that you've reworked molds and the models are better now.
Right.
Is there any way for people who already have all the stat cards and stuff like that for those classes to maybe just buy just the new models, the updated sculpt models for those specific resin ones?
Right. Well, I don't think we would do something through the store where it's like a product. But if you email admin, we can try to, you know, help you guys out.
Okay, because as I said, I know that, like, you know, the nun model, I've seen someone has an original nun model and then their friend got the new nun kit, one of these, you know, last times you had a sale when the nun was out, and the model is, you know, slightly bigger and better detailed than the original one that people got. So it's just, we're fine paying extra to get those upgraded models. We just, it would be not good for us to buy the whole character set again because we already have all the tokens and everything.
Yeah. Well, the other thing is, like, I'll tell you the secret, as long as nobody tells, the secret is we didn't just replace the models just for fun. We did it because we're redoing the sculpts for doing them in plastic. And while well, the plastic models aren't done yet. You know, you have to have all the ones for a mold. They have to be cut into parts. And there's a whole engineering thing that takes place after the sculpting is done. We have,
and it takes a really long time to actually tool the molds for plastic injection molding stuff.
It's a lot of back and forth with China and working with their team. They make a lot of changes because they know things that we don't about how the, you know, liquid plastic folds, you know, goes through a mold. And so they know a bunch of stuff that basically, unless you are an engineer who tools molds, you know, out of steel, you don't really know. You have no call for that. And so it's a lot of back and forth where we're like, here's what we want. And then they say, oh, this won't work because it won't go through the channel, or, oh, this needs to be a separate piece. And then, you know, sometimes they'll try it and we'll say, ooh, that's super ugly. We need to redo that. And, you know, way back when we were less involved in the nuts and bolts of this, like when the miniatures were being done by the previous factory that we were working with, they would just do it. And they would talk to us. And so we'd get back this thing where we're like, what did you do? Why would you do that? And they're like, oh, it's better for the, you know, tooling through the channel or whatever. And we'd say, well, yeah, but the end result model looked horrible. So now we're more hands-on and we get better results. But what I was really getting at is the fact that...
Is Troy logging in, Heather?
Somebody's having a super conversation.
So are you guys going to be doing plastic sculpts of like the gamblers and the orphans and stuff that currently are just...
Yes, exactly.
Oh, and so there's plastics coming out in the future.
That was always the point. That's why it says that it's a preview. It's just been in preview for a long time because we haven't had a chance to go back and resculpt all of those heroes.
Okay. So we'll just wait for the plastics to come out instead of buying the new resin ones then.
Yeah. Either way, but what I was going to say is the reason why we redid the resin molds is it got to a point where, hey, the mold is getting worn out. Let's do a new mold. But why do it of the previous one? Why not use the new sculpt? And so in a way, it's basically a sneak peek at what the plastics are going to look like, where the proportions are better. You know, cleaner model, better textures, more detail.
Higher detail.
Yeah. And so, yeah, and so those
often,
ones
often there's slight variation on the poses too.
Yeah. So
do you
so
have even a ballpark figure?
I'm sorry, what?
Do you have even a ballpark time frame for that?
It's a little
one
bit
year, too 2 years.
Oh, it'll be within a year, but
awesome.
not necessarily for all of them. They're probably going to be done in rounds. So like round one will be, I would say, certainly within a year.
Fantastic.
I have a question I'd very much like to ask.
We have a question direct from the orbiting space station.
Yeah.
Sorry. The effect on your microphone sounds a little distant. Go ahead.
Probably won't be able to stay up till the end of this. Really tired. Got up at 3 a.m. yesterday to buy new stuff for my favorite dungeon crawler. So I figure I better get my question in now.
Oh, okay. Well, we appreciate that. Let's get your question in.
Can U.S.-based people expect Wave 3 to arrive at their homes?
Can U.S.-based people expect Wave 3? You mean Phase 3?
Yeah. I think there should have been a Wing. Wing can.
Yeah, I think
a Wing.
He's asking what our prediction of delivery time on Phase 3 is.
Okay, I thought you were saying, will it happen? I'm like, yeah. exactly when it's been really hard for us to estimate because
COVID.
Yeah, even when like people on the news you would see and they would say like, great news, the factories are back open in China, and we'd be like, oh my gosh, we better get on the horn with China, and we'd call them and they're like, yes, we're opening. And then when we would actually try to get something done, they would come clean and say, yeah, there's only two people in the factory. And so it's like technically we're open, but we actually can't do anything.
Yeah, there's so much of it that's kind of political where they, you know, information coming out of China is they want to look good. They want everyone to think that they're back up and running, but they have these ebb and flows where, you know, they'll be like, oh, good news. We have a group of people that are coming back to start working the factories again, but they have to be in quarantine for 14 days before they can start. So on this date, they should be back. And then we'll talk to them over the next few weeks. And then when we talk to them again, they're like, oh, they had to readjust because more cases broke out. And so now it's going to be another month and a half. And so it's this rolling these rolling dates that it's really almost impossible to actually get anybody nailed down on. And so when we give out dates, we were more likely to want to give out dates earlier in this pandemic because we believed the dates that we were getting. But the longer it's gone, the more it's made us wary of giving out specifics, because we never know when another rug is going to get pulled out from under us. So, I mean, right now we have a lot of the plastics we can show tonight for most of the phase three stuff, where the plastics are done. We've got final production plastic samples on everything. But a lot of it comes down to like manufacturing schedules and the timing of when they can actually put stuff through to be printed, to be assembled, to be combined from different factories, to be packed into cargo containers. The other thing that a lot of people don't really realize, I think, is that there's a lot of slowdown on the manufacturing in general, which means that the shipping, the ocean freight shipping from China has, common sense would make you think, oh, that means there's not a lot of competition, so it's easy to get a vessel booking. But what it really means is that the ocean liners have decided, oh, we only have 10% of stuff moving, so we're going to shrink down to, less than 10% of the ships going back and forth. And so what it really means is it's huge congestion, and there'd be these long windows of like weeks where just no ships are going at all, or there are so few ships you just can't get a booking. And so there's a lot of hurdles to overcome. So it's difficult for us to give a really specific time frame. That being said, most of the stuff is in manufacturing right now. The only bits that aren't are things where they wouldn't be able to manufacture it right away. So we've held off on handing off the final assets on our end so that we can keep playtesting. Because ultimately, you can kind of turn a little bit of lemons into lemonade if you say, well, we know it's going to be at least another month before they could actually get this on the schedule. We'll just spend that time actually playing out the missions for Feudal Village more and, making sure that everything is as polished and top-notch as it can be.
Mom's going to be late. Logan wouldn't really eat any, so I was just like...
Does that make sense?
That's why I had to
get it brought back. Is it going to be here in our home or not?
Yeah. So we're working really hard to get the stuff before the end of the year.
Hey, don't worry at this time.
Obviously, we can't make any specific date promises for all the reasons that I just mentioned. But that's kind of our goal, is to try and get the stuff as soon as possible and to try and deliver that to as many areas as we can by the end of the year. One thing I will say is that we are working on trying to have more stuff sent directly from China to the regional hubs so that it can cut out the middleman of having to come to the US and then go to Australia, come to the US and then go to the EU. And so we did that on phase one, and I think it helped a lot for getting stuff out to people faster. It meant that we could kind of simultaneously ship all over the world. And so we're working really hard to do that on phase three as well.
What are you guys still playtesting at this point?
At this point, it's pretty much the last bits of Feudal Village, just again, to sort of make it as polished as it can be before it goes out the door.
Does that mean that there'll be further delay on Adventures?
We're still playtesting Adventures stuff as well and still working on it. On the Kickstarter for Adventures, we did talk about delays based on the COVID stuff. One thing that's kind of rough is that we normally would be able to handle a lot more simultaneous playtesting of the different parts of the games, both for the last bits of Feudal Village and for the Brimstone Adventures. But when you're working remotely, it ends up being a lot harder to get frequent and effective playtesting. So what it means is we tend to be down to a lot fewer playtest sessions than we normally would have, which means it kind of slows down the process, slows down the progress on everything. So I mean, we're kind of bouncing back and forth to try to make sure that, you know, as little impact as possible happens to either, you know, the last bits of phase three or Brimstone Adventures. But again, with the quarantine and working remotely, it ends up, you know, making everything kind of slow development.
No, hey guys, I'm happy to help playtesting if you are looking for anybody.
Ditto.
Yeah.
Hey guys, this is
and Davros.
I think a lot of us, they'd get a lot of volunteers if they were looking for them, who wouldn't want to be able to playtest the new stuff, even if it is still an alpha beta testing stage.
I think that, so, Lawrence Michael was going to ask a question.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Thank you, guys. First of all, this is Lawrence Michael. I'm in San Jose, California. Hello to everybody and to you guys. I want to say thank you so much for a great product. I love it. My first introduction to it is Forbidden Fortress.
Oh, right.
I did not, yeah, but then, you know, once I signed up for the Kickstarter for Forbidden Fortress, I like, what is this? Shadows of Brimstone. And then before you know it, I'm buying both sets and buying like little packs here and there. So absolutely love it. Congrats to you guys. Absolutely excited about all the endless possibilities that you guys have out there. So I'm looking forward to everything. And I've signed up for adventures, absolutely. My question actually was because, and maybe it's kind of twofold, is I attended the Japanese Folklore and Mythology seminar this afternoon as part of Gen Con, which I loved, obviously. She talked about, you know, the Tengu and the Oni and the Kitsune, which I love. But she did mention the Kappa, which I'm like, oh yeah, the Kappa is something that I'm very familiar with. How come you guys didn't add that? And I guess the question is, why didn't you add it? And is there an option to maybe add it in the future? Or maybe you guys are just done with Forbidden Fortress at this point, other than Feudal Village, and you're on to adventures and whatever else the future holds for you.
Yeah.
Jason was attacked by a turtle as a young boy. No, I'm just kidding.
Okay, I'm lame. So what is it you're talking about, Lawrence?
What's so this? Yeah, it's a mythological creature that's part turtle. And it's sort of a cross between human and turtle. And one of the things about Koopa. It is that it tends to attack people. And that they, one of the mythological things about it is that they have like a bowl or depression in their head where they have water in it. And one of the things about it is that if they spill the water, then they lose their strength or their power. And something that I learned today that from the speaker is that they happen, even though they'll attack you and tend to be evil, they're also very subject to protocol and etiquette. So one of the ways to get away from them is to bow in front of them, and they will have no choice but to bow back, thereby spilling the water from the top of their head. That is the source of their power. So anyways, I thought that was really interesting. Which
that
I
is yeah. very Japanese.
That or throw a cucumber at them.
Well, I mean,
that's right.
Maybe we should start by talking for a second about some of the actual Japanese mythology creatures that we did use, because a lot of people probably think we're just really strange guys with bizarre imaginations, but a lot of it is really pulled from traditional Japanese mythology. And some of them, like the Akaname,
yeah.
I don't think people would believe that that's actually from Japanese folklore. It's these things that they break into your... Yeah, they're called filth lickers. They're Akaname, and they break into your house and they lick the floor of your bathroom. It's super disturbing. I don't fully understand it, but
yeah, there's some really weird things. They talked about a demon that comes in your house when you're sleeping just to take your pillow and move it to the foot of the bed, and that's all they do.
Yes. Well, you have to handle
that. Would make a good enemies pack right there.
Yeah, that's right. Maybe it could be like a trait pack, and it could just be a trait of a bunch of different things. You could have a night terror that just likes to move pillows. These aren't just any night terrors. These are pillow-moving night terrors.
I'm trying to picture the people that have mixed the sets and have the outlaws moving pillows.
Exactly.
So I guess the question is, are there going to be enemy packs for Forbidden Fortress in the future, or are you sort of just like done with it and moving on?
Yeah, no. I would say there absolutely will be. I mean, the bottom line is that there's a ton of crazy mythological creatures in Japanese folklore and legend that you can't get all of them in one go. We picked ones that we thought would make particularly good enemies and would mash up really well with the unspeakable horror vibe. So the Akiname is a good example of that, with their bathroom licking, long tongues, and their penchant for leaping around. It seems like there's some just good, enemy mechanics that you can work into that, and there's some really good, kind of unspeakable horror vibe that they give off, where they specifically, they're all about surprising you when you get up in the middle of the night to hit the bathroom, you know? So, so it seems like, we tried to pick ones that were super iconic and would work really well, both for unspeakable horror and the mechanics, would make them fun and different and varied. That being said, the intent is to continue to support enemies for all the different regions that we do expansions for. So whether it's the Old West, or whether it's feudal Japan, or Vikings, or conquistadors, Central American, Mesoamerican stuff, even beyond whatever Kickstarter project includes material for that, that we would be able to do more stuff in the future. It's nice because it gives us the opportunity to do a Kickstarter and get a big chunk of it as like a baseline, so that everybody's on board and sees like, okay, this is everything you need to start playing in this genre, in this kind of world. And then we can sort of add to it over time, and we can kind of trickle out additional enemies or additional material for that genre over time.
I always wonder.
Not Shirimi.
I always wonder.
You don't like the butt eye yokai?
I would prefer not.
Yeah, I saw that on the Facebook group.
Yeah, I saw that too.
Believe it or not, that was actually one that we were looking at, but ultimately it seemed like...
Well, it was looking at us.
Yeah, exactly. Ultimately, it seemed like that one would probably make a better encounter card than an enemy set. You do find that a lot more in Forbidden Fortress than in the Old West themed sets, is specific folklore and legends showing up as encounters that you run into rather than just purely as enemy sets.
Well, the other thing is, maybe that would be a better player hero class. I'm just kidding. Yeah.
We have a couple of critters in the Blasted Wastes. The Carnuto, what are the two things? There's two of them. One is like a, I don't know, somebody was talking about like getting them as a mount or something. But there's a couple of creatures, and you don't explain what they are.
You're talking about stuff in the travel hazard chart or in the town.
In the town.
Yeah, yeah. But there's also one, I think it's a travel hazard, and somebody was going to make up a scenario where they hatched the eggs, and I can't remember the name of it. But we're wondering, because we have the description of these, that, yeah, it was like a stampede or something. So we got the names. We got to need a face to put to it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's nice to have little stubs in there that are things we can go back later and revisit. And it's kind of rewarding when you do, because 99% of the people will just be like, oh, look, it's a new enemy. But there's that 1% that's like, oh, this is totally from that thing. And, you can see, like, for example, when we had the Trun up here on Targa, there were like a few people that played Conquest of Planet Earth that were like, oh, I can't believe they made the Trun in Shadows of Brimstone. And we made that just for those people. I mean, everybody can enjoy the Trun, but we genuinely made it for those people. And they can truly appreciate it.
And the same thing with like the Order of the Crimson Hand and things like that. Having, crossovers between all the different games and because the intent is that all of the games that we make more or less take place in the same world in some capacity, means that it's fun to have those little Easter eggs that pop up across games and across expansions and across other worlds and things like that. And you'll actually see one of those in the Brimstone Adventures Kickstarter as well. One of the social media goals we had was the Sateris Ravagers, which are kind of alien pterodactyl looking guys that have kind of lasers and big wings. And those are actually also one of the alien races you can play in Conquest of Planet Earth.
They look like glam rockers or something in the picture.
Yeah, a little bit.
Well, I'll tell you what, before we go too far, I've seen a couple people where they had to go, and we definitely recognize that, people on the East Coast or maybe in other countries, it might be very late for them. So So why don't we quickly go through kind of development stuff, and then we'll go back to kind of questions and hanging out and talking about stuff. So if we look, I'm going to pin Mary Beth's view here. Here's the actual plastic Otakuro. And
Do we have another figure we can put by that, a human-sized figure we can put by that for scale?
I don't know. Is Mary Beth listening? I heard
that looks so bad.
Disembodied hand.
So that's actually one of the new Hungry Dead from the revised core set from Swamps of Death. But it is human-sized. So you can see Mary Beth, can you place it in his hand where he's grabbing him?
Do that picture right.
Look at that.
So this is the actual final production plastic off the frame and assembled. And it should be the pretty much one for one for what we showed at Dice Fest last year, which was a 3D print.
I assume there's no Dice Fest this year.
Actually, there is. We talked about it earlier on the
Facebook live
stream that we did. We're doing a Dice Fest online this year. So we'll have more details for that later, but I can tell you the dates right now for that are October 24th and 25th for Dice Fest Online.
Cool.
Any chance that the Scafford Gang supplement number 2 might be for sale at your web store during Dice Fest Online?
All I can say about that is we'll have to wait and see.
That's a yes.
What? If I was going to say yes, I would have just said yes. I specifically am being coy. Don't ruin my being coy.
COVID.
Okay, all right.
which month was the Dice Fest Online?
Dice Fest Online is scheduled for October 24th and 25th. It's a Saturday-Sunday weekend. And we'll have more information on that as we get closer to it. So you can see, if you're still seeing the preview of the figures there, I think Scott's showing off the Takobake Samurai. Is everybody seeing that?
Yeah. We are.
Yes. Nice. Yep. Yes. Thank you.
So these, again, are the final production plastics. And you can see they're on 40-millimeter large bases because they're basically monstrous giant honor guard for the Takobake. And one of the things that's pretty cool about these guys is that they actually have a deck of battle tactics, much like the samurai, samurai heroes. And they, whenever they roll sixes to hit, they trigger one of their battle tactics. So it's kind of like a critical hit for them. But they'll do things like wrap you in one of their tentacles and squeeze you, or do like a chop, 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 and do a bunch of rapid hacks with their sword, things like that. And it's pretty cool because when you're fighting them, it ends up making them feel very different. Like every attack, you never know exactly what they're going to do. It's not just simply them rolling dice at you. They'll do crazy maneuvers depending on if they get those critical hits against you.
Is one of their attacks a massive slice you in half one? You mentioned that. And
there is a massive slice you in half one. It the slicing in half, usually it's not going to slice a hero in half, but it might slice an ally in half. So that's the Takobake Samurai and the Otakuro. So unfortunately, it sounds like we don't have a set of the assembled plastic feudal bandits. We can show a sprue. Just the assembled ones are actually at the studio right now. So we're not going to be able to show the assembled guys, but we can show pictures of them and show them on the sprue. And those were actually the last of the final production plastics for us to get samples of. But they turned out really cool. And Scott's showing a sprue of those right there. And so you can see that there are four of these guys on the sprue, and they're kind of semi-posable in how you assemble them. There's different heads that can go on any of the four bodies. There's different arms that can go on two of the bodies. And there's four different main kind of poses And so because you get 12 of those in the Feudal Village box, you can kind of assemble them to look, to have quite a bit of variety amongst the grouping.
Better than a loss.
So do you guys have the finals for all the plastics for the third wave?
We have samples for the final production.
Samples, plastic. That's what I meant to say.
Yeah, yeah. We didn't get an actual shipment because they're going to be assembled over in China. So it wouldn't make sense for us to ship full production plastics to us. But we have final production samples of all the Phase 3 miniatures.
Basically, this is how they're going to look, period.
Yeah, so I mean, this is the real deal. These are the final productions. This is what you'll see coming out of the boxes when they arrive. And so you can see the Oni Warlord here is a giant, and he's got a giant wooden slave cage on his shoulder and a massive club. And the Oni are well known for having tiger pants, hashtag tiger pants. And you can see that because this guy is so big, his tiger pants are made of a bunch of full tigers. It's not just tiger skin wrapped around him. He's got like four or five tigers as his pants.
Yeah, some of the items you find in the mines, I feel very bad when my heroes have to put them on after discovering a pair of Oni pants or golden teeth. They just kind of shove them in their mouth. Kind of disgusting.
Well, you know, in the Old West or in feudal Japan, people are probably a lot more discerning about personal hygiene and things like that.
How'd you get out of the box if a Kuma Oni puts you in it?
So when you get stuffed into the slave cage, you actually have to make a strength test every turn to try and force your way out. And if there are multiple heroes in there, you can actually use the strength of the highest strength hero in there. So you can help each other to try to break out of the cage if he stuffs you in there.
Is he an XXL large enemy like Bilal?
He is an XXL enemy. You can see there's a tiny looking hungry dead there standing beside him. So you can see
I'll put a human hero figure in.
Okay. He really towers over most other models.
Hello. Hey, anybody.
So if all the heroes get caught in the box, do you lose?
Okay.
If all of the heroes get stuffed into the slave cage, you can lose, yeah.
You're welcome.
Cool.
Yeah. So you don't want to get all stuffed in there at once. That's not good for anybody. Yeah, it looks like he put some normal size heroes there. I think that's supposed to be a subtle showing off of the injection plastic conquistadors from Brimstone Adventure, Valley of the Serpent Kings. So these are actually, just as a little preview, these are some guys that we got the first samples of just recently with the final injection plastic conquistadors. So we'll be showing these off more
at the
Brimstone Adventures event that we do in a couple days. Yeah, the detail on these guys came out really, really nice.
Just one more question. Does it come with Oni trait cards, Akuma Oni, and are you supposed to use those always or just in his mission?
That's a good question. So I will say, originally, the Oni Warlord pack was only going to come with one Oni trait for blue Oni that were specifically for Oni that run slave mines, having people work in the mines to dig Darkstone for them. And it was a single trait card that's themed for some of the missions and stuff that you encounter with the Oni Warlord. But in development, there were a lot of cool ideas for more Oni traits. And so that actually was expanded out to be a full set of five Oni traits. So the Oni Warlord actually comes with a full set of five Oni traits. There's a few different colors in there, like there's green Oni and black Oni, and then each of them has a different name for their type of Oni and a different set of abilities like traits normally have. But those basically can be used in normal games as well as in specific missions.
Awesome.
Cool.
Yeah, and we actually have some material we were going to show some printed material from the different phase three items. If you guys want to see that, I imagine you do. That's probably one of the reasons you're here. So, Scott, did you want to show any of that? You want to share your screen and show some of that stuff?
I have to bring it up just a second. Maybe you could buy me some time by talking about.
Give us
more of the colors of Oni.
So the when you're looking at these different enemy sets here, really the four main items that are part of phase three are the Otakuro, who's an XXL enemy set, and he's the biggest. I think he's the biggest enemy we've done to date. I mean, he's not the tallest certainly, but his base is huge. His skull is huge. His reach is huge. And so he's an XXL enemy. Then there's a regular enemy pack that is the Takobake Samurai. And much like the Thunder Warriors, because they're three larger enemies and have more cards and a little bit more going on, they actually come with a mission in their pack as well for taking on the Fallen Shogun's, you know, elite honor guard. And go ahead. So that's two of the packs, the XXL Otakuro, the enemy pack for the Takabake Samurai. There's also the Oni Warlord.
Adam?
He's an XL.
Adam? Yeah. Hold on one
more. The Oni Warlord is an XXL enemy as well, but he is actually a deluxe enemy set, which means he comes with two different missions as well as a bunch of different cards. You know, like those Oni traits I was talking about. He actually comes with, he's kind of an enemy, deluxe enemy set that bridges the gap between the Old West core sets and the Forbidden Fortress core set, because the Oni are renowned for having their slave mines where they force people to dig Darkstone for them. And so there's actually an adventure card for two different adventure cards in the Oni Warlord deluxe enemy set. One is for having an adventure in an Oni castle, and the other is for having an adventure in an Oni slave mine.
I wonder what mine tiles you could use.
Oh, I got a quick question based on the mission comments. Is there any chance us Kickstarter backers could ever get a combined folio of all the missions from the different Kickstarters? Because some are really tiny in those booklets we got.
You know, it's hard to say. It's always possible. We've talked many times about doing things like a player handbook or doing things like a mission book. A lot of it just comes down to having the time to put it together and having the bandwidth in the manufacturing schedule to actually get that kind of thing put together and printed and delivered and all of that.
So
it's possible. I would never say no, but it's not something that's currently on the docket.
Something like that with a mission generator might be interesting.
Yeah, it's always possible. Why don't you bring up the Takobake Samurai stuff? We'll talk about them first.
All right. Can everybody see this?
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah, mate.
So this is a new painting for the cover of the Takobake Samurai, done by an artist in Poland named Mariusz Gonzel. He is fantastic. He's actually done a lot of art for Forbidden Fortress. So the other thing we have in here is, if I can get it to work, here's the actual stats for the Takobake Samurai. It looks a little bit, it's in CMYK format, so it looks a little bit saturated, but.
Sorry, that's probably my bad. I think I put the files in there.
It's terrifying.
So Scott, I'll also say, I did just drop in a few of the front faces of Takobake Samurai Battle Tactics.
Okay.
So you can show some of those as well. I just grabbed three of them that are pretty cool.
Okay.
So you can see these guys are pretty tough. Having regeneration and armor makes them pretty rough, and their sword deflect is pretty cool. They can actually, because of their kind of preternatural senses from being Darkstone enhanced, they can deflect shots for ranged attacks with their sword, which bumps their armor up for ranged attacks.
Well, they're going to be a nightmare.
Yeah.
Well, that's part of the plan.
Especially since some characters have things that ignore armor, and you can't ignore their armor.
Can't ignore their armor. They're just that mean. Scott, do you want to spin on to maybe a couple of the battle tactics?
Ooh.
So you can see this has got a similar layout to the samurai warrior battle tactics, or the wandering samurai battle tactics, or the daimyo battle tactics. But these are specifically Takobake battle tactics.
Who's your next activation?
That's cool. Wow.
So, you know, giving them these special abilities, an entire deck of special abilities where they can wrap their tentacles around your neck and choke you, or have a deadly slice to try to slice into you and give you an injury.
Injury table.
Sheesh! Hi.
And you can see some of these abilities actually have a bonus if they're a brutal version of the enemy. So if they're on that red brutal side, then the samurai battle tactics kind of get elevated and are even more deadly.
That's interesting.
Madanya says I can use any battle tactics. Does that include these?
that unfortunately does not include the Takobake battle tactics because they wouldn't make a whole lot. Maybe in the future, we'll have some way of playing a Takobake daimyo or Takobake samurai so that you can be mutated and have some crazy battle tactics. Could be fun.
We already have that Takobake starting item, personal item.
Yeah, that makes you makes it so that you once were part of the Takobake clan, but left in disgust when they went full on mutations.
My sumo has that.
Yeah, you're an ex Takobake sumo.
Yep.
Nice.
It would be interesting if we could get spellbook artifacts that let you draw like a random shadow magic or spider magic. You know, sort of like a tome of forbidden knowledge.
Yeah. Yeah. You never know. So it looks like, Scott, you've moved on to the Oni Warlord. So you can see this here is, I believe that's the cover of the Oni Warlord. Right?
Yep. This one's actually also by Marius, the same illustrator.
Yeah, it's definitely such a style.
You can see this Oni Warlord leading his giant troop of Oni, slashing and burning the villages in the countryside.
Both of his missions involve finding him and killing him, or just one?
Ooh. So his missions, one of them is to rescue somebody that he's kidnapped in his slave cage, and the other one is actually to hunt down a group of we'll come back to that in a second when we get to the cards. I can show you. So you can see these are some of the Oni traits. We probably don't need to linger on these too long because there's quite a bit of stuff to show off here. But you can see, actually, if you go back to guards just for a second, now that I said that, guards is kind of a cool one because in the one of the adventure cards in the Oni Warlord, it has an ability in the adventure card that when you're playing an Oni castle mission, there's extra guards wandering around the castle. And so whenever you come to doors, it's possible that it'll have one or two Oni guards guarding the door. And so you'll get more fights specifically with Oni guards when you're doing an Oni castle.
I find it funny that Oni guards are apparently bred to have less help than their brethren.
Well, I mean, they obviously take the ones that are the slowest and stick them on guard duty because they can't really chase people down.
The ones with the smallest tiger pants.
He took an arrow in the knee.
Demon hate.
Demonic hate. Yeah.
He's hulking out.
I think the Incredible Hulk must have demonic hate.
Brutish terrors. And ooh. Born from darkness.
I love the color of these guys.
That's good.
Yeah.
Over.
So that's the different Oni traits in the Oni Warlord pack. Then we can see some of the different legendary Oni Warlords. So the main Oni Warlord is kind of a red. And so this is one of the legendary ones. It's Akuma Oki, who's the one that was specifically called out by name during the Kickstarter. And he's sort of the biggest, baddest of all the Oni Warlords out there. And you can see he's kind of a darker blood red. with glowing eyes, and he's also got a tattoo on his chest of some kanji there. And you can see he actually has some different abilities there, where he leads the entire Nobuhara clan. And so he's got a big slave army where he can press gang other low threats into fighting for him as part of the slave army. So he might have, you know, night terrors or, you know, Tengu or things like that that come out that are part of his Nobu army.
Tentacles.
You yep, really tentacles. Don't like our heroes, do you?
Yeah, well, you know, this guy would be pretty nasty.
Yeah, well, you know, everybody always says that sometimes the game gets too easy on you, and so, you know, gotta make it, gotta give you some good options for knocking your heroes down.
Yeah, every time
I've been dying every time.
Every time you say that, an Oni gets his wings.
So if you spin on the next one there is, there's
horns,
actually-
Horns, they get horns.
There's three different legendary Oni warlords in the set. There's Akuma Oki, who's the leader of the Nobu clan. There's Todai, who's the king under the city. And so he lives basically in these underground tunnels under a major city in feudal Japan there. And you can see he actually has a death cage instead of a slave cage, where it has zombies that can crawl out of the cage and attack you.
And that gives cool. new meaning to what's in the box.
That's right. Box. And so this last one is Yurei Oni. And he's actually, you can see the description there says, these four albino brothers were cast out from their Oni tribe at birth, set to roam the wild. Each fashioned its own death relic to ensnare and feed upon the souls of mortal men. And so you can see he actually has regeneration and keepers of death, where he starts with a death relic. So the idea is that this Oni, legendary Oni, there's actually four of, and each one has a slightly different variation on the theme based on the death relic that he has. So one of the missions in this set is a four-part mission where you can try to hunt down and defeat all four of the Yurei Oni.
Like the amulet mission?
Very much like the amulet. So you can. So it has the main rules for the mission and then a little sub page for each of the specific special rules for that particular Yurei Oni that you're fighting or that you're hunting down.
But maybe you could actually defeat all four at once. with the explosive barrels.
That's true. You can play insane mode and have all four Yurei Oni come out at you once. So go ahead and spin on to the next one. You can see some of the...
There are going to be for the Oni Warlords.
Yeah, the Oni Warlord ended up being a really massive deluxe enemy set. I think people are going to be pretty excited when they get their hands on the Oni Warlord pack.
Yeah.
So Scott, do you want to spin on to the next slide there? So these are some of the Oni death relics that the Yurei Oni have. The soul net is one where he can capture the souls in the net. He's like a fisherman themed. The next one there is Shiro's clay pot, where basically instead of a slave cage, he's got a giant clay pot that's full of acid to dissolve things in. So when he throws you in the slave cage, it's actually the clay pot, and you take bleeding markers every turn until you can escape because it's slowly dissolving you. The bottomless sack, he can stuff things in. And the last one is the undying urn, which actually is tainted by shadow magic. And so it actually gives him the ability, this Yurei Oni, the ability to cast shadow magic spells. And you may ask, well, what if I don't have Belial or the Hellfire Succubi? What if I don't have any shadow magic? And that would mean that Scott needs to spin to the next slide. Oh, it's not in order. So sad. All right. Well, you can see the two things we're talking about there. Oh, look, there it is, shadow magic. So there's actually a small deck of shadow magic cards, that are in the set just for that Yurei Oni that has the urn. And of course, as shadow magic, these can be put into the regular shadow magic deck as well and give more spells to the Hellfire Succubi. You know, Hellfire Witch, more spells to Belial, and more spells to the Yurei Oni.
The Harbinger.
Is that just what Belial needs, is more stuff to throw at you?
Well, of course. Ooh. So one of the things that's pretty crazy with this Yurei Oni mission is that each of the four Yurioni are actually, they live in a different magically tainted area of Japan. And so each one has its own dangerous earth environment that utilizes one of the map tile sets out there, but has a different spin on it. So one of them actually lives in the deep forest, which uses the Forest of the Dead map tile set. And you use this world card when you go on that adventure to hunt down that Yurioni in the deep forest. And there's four of these, one for each of the different brothers. And so when you do that mission, you choose which Yurioni you want to fight. And that tells you what, which of these dangerous earth environment world cards to use and which death relic that he has. So you can spin to the next one there.
This is like 12 expansions in one.
Yeah, there's a lot going on.
It should have been like a mystery box or something.
And one of the things that's kind of cool with these dangerous earth environments is they're not other worlds per se. So anything that triggers off of being in an other world would not trigger off of these. They're considered part of an earth environment. But they use the tile set and some of the card decks for that world. But they also use some of the normal decks, like they use the normal threat deck and whatnot for, you know, the Feudal Japan set, the Forbidden Fortress set, I should say. And you can use these for the Yurioni mission. You can also just mix them into your world decks. And when you find a portal, maybe now it might lead to a dangerous earth environment. So it leads to a dark swamp instead of the swamps of Jargono, or it leads to, you know, the island fortress instead of Caverns of Cinder, or whatever other world it might have led to before. So it gives you four new world cards that are a different way to use some of the worlds that you may already have.
I have a question about these world cards. Do they replace the existing one? So if you drew Fire Caves, you don't also have the regular Caverns of Cinder world effects, you just have this one?
Correct. Because technically you're not in the Caverns of Cinder, you're in the Fire Caves on Earth.
Right. Cool. That's very cool.
And so it's cool because it basically gives a new world card that has new world effects with, you know, while using the map tiles for Caverns of Cinder or for Forest of the Dead or whatever world it happens to be.
Is it possible to find a portal from the Fire Caves to Cinder?
Sure.
Sure.
I mean, it would be possible to find a portal cave from Cinder to Cinder. So, I mean, it really just depends on how you want to draw your world cards. And, you know, it's kind of cool because it lets you see the worlds you already have potentially in a different light.
This has got to be the
most... You can't find a portal.
Yeah, there's an awful...
Could you say that again?
A lot of material.
This has got to be the most deluxe enemy set ever.
I agree.
I really like the tile ideas.
I don't know if this will fit in a box.
You can't find a portal from Cinder to Cinder, though, can you?
I guess
sure, you can
depends.
Always shuffle it back into the world deck if you
yeah, you're not
you
have supposed more than one Cinder card. That's true.
It depends how you want to use your world cards and you know, that most people wouldn't want to because it keeps it different. But one way that you find that a lot is with, say, the mines, where you may have multiple world cards for the mines. And so even if you're in the mines, you might find a portal that leads to another copy of the mines.
Jason, did you want to talk about the adventure cards here?
Sure. I already did a little bit. There's the two adventure cards, the Oni Castle and the Oni Slave Mine and the Nobu Slave Mine. And so each of these actually has a set of five encounters that have the little icon on there. And so they're specifically Nobu Mine encounters and specifically the Oni Castle encounters. So you can either mix those into your normal decks, or if you're playing with the adventure card, you can have those separate and they'll layer on like the other adventure cards in the game. Here you can see the Oni Warlord enemy record sheet. And for those of you that saw this at Dice Fest last year, you'll notice that it is changed around quite a bit based on, you know, more development, more playtesting and whatnot. It used to be that the Akuma Oki, leader of the Nobu clan, was on here, kind of like the Show Ryu rules are for the Dragon King, the dragon, I should say. But that ended up getting split off into those legendary Oni Warlord cards. And so this Oni Warlord enemy record sheet is dedicated just to the abilities that all Oni Warlords have.
Can I ask a real quick question here?
Sure.
Yeah.
So with the other worlds that come with them, you would use the Japanese-themed monsters and not the Cinder monsters, for example?
Yeah, so generally speaking, it's that for the dangerous Earth environments, they don't count as an other world, and you use the map deck, encounters, and depth event chart from the listed other world, but you use the threat decks and the artifacts for the Earth-based world that you're using. In this case, Forbidden Fortress, because it has the little Japanese flower icon.
Right.
So, you'll find threats and artifacts from the Forbidden Fortress world, but you'll use the map deck, encounters, and depth event chart from whatever, you know, in this case, the Caverns of Cinder.
Which encounter deck would you use?
The map deck, encounters, and depth events are for, in this case, Caverns of Cinder. It's for whatever the map tile set is.
Gotcha.
And fire effects are still inactive, even though they're, if you're like you're in Cinder, the fire effects would be active.
Yeah, the lava spaces aren't part of the world card. They're just part of the map tiles. So there isn't one of these for Tradera, but if there was, the radiation spaces would still give radiation, if that makes sense. Because those aren't part of the world card, they're part of the map tiles.
That's what I thought. And you would already know that because you have the Cinder pack.
Yeah.
Medwin had a question in the chat some bit back about rules. And so I'm not sure if you can see the chat, Jason, and can scroll back a little bit. But apparently their microphone wasn't working. So they asked a question and wanted somebody to ask it on their behalf.
Is it in the,
chat
somewhere?
Yeah, scroll.
Does any person unify or handle rules discrepancies?
If they have any intentions to address, unify, handle rules discrepancies.
I mean, wasn't a lot of that done in the FAQ?
Yeah, I mean, it would be in the FAQ if there's anything that's specific. I mean, are there specific concerns for rules discrepancies? Like, is there a specific discrepancy they're referring to?
He didn't say this.
We have our chat. We have a nice thread on, you guys are busy. I know, but we have a good thread on Board Games Geek. Opens up a lot of different questions after we kind of go through them as a community. I don't know if that's kind of the thing he's referring to. I know it's kind of hard. You get swamped looking at something.
Yeah. I've seen the running thread on Board Game Geek, and I don't make it over to Board Game Geek as often as I used to, but usually when I'm working on updating the FAQ, I'll pop over there and kind of look through that thread and find things that would make sense to add, or add things to the FAQ that are going to address multiple issues at once. So it's definitely a good resource to have. You know, I appreciate that you guys do that, and it helps make the game better, I think.
I think a lot of the conversations these days are about how specific upgrades or items interact with the six dice attack cap limit.
Yeah, I think that will probably be addressed a lot more with the revised core sets for Shadows of Brimstone. There's a few changes to the way that works, and I think it'll also eliminate a lot of the outlying cases. Are you talking specifically about Forbidden Fortress stuff, or do people talk specifically about Forbidden Fortress stuff with that? I mean, there's a few that are definitely affected, you know, potentially Fists of Fury and things like that for the Traveling Monk.
Yeah, but, the Bandito, too, where it gets the high grit plus four combo.
Yeah.
They're all along the same lines.
Yeah, so, I mean, well, we're going to talk about it more in the live stream tomorrow for going over the revised core sets for the Old West Shadows of Brimstone, as well as the rest of the new releases and whatnot that we were going to talk about. But I can give you a little sneak preview of that. And that is that There is a change in the revised core set rulebook. It'll be in the next FAQ as well, but it actually shifts the 6 dice cap limit to 8. So it gives a little bit more wiggle room for heroes. You know, when we were originally doing the 6 dice cap limit, we were going back and forth a lot between whether it should be 6 or 8. And, you know, we were trying it both ways. And 6, it seemed like it was better to be more aggressive with it first. And then if we needed or felt like it would be better served to sort of scale it back a little bit, that's a lot easier to do than to say, oh, it's a dice cap limit of 8. Oh, wait, actually, it's going to be 6. You know what I'm saying? So it made sense to be more aggressive with it, get a lot more play with it out in the wild, get a lot more people's opinions on it out in the wild, and then you know, see how that integrates with the revised core set changes to those skill trees and those abilities of the classic 8 heroes. So with that change, that's going to be in the revised core set rulebook, the skill cap, or the, excuse me, the attack dice, hero attack dice cap of 8 rather than 6. But with that actually comes along, and this doesn't affect Forbidden Fortress as much, but it definitely affects the Old West more. It comes along with a change to the dual wielding rules for ranged attacks.
Oh, what's that?
So one of the big things that makes heroes tend to have a lot of power creep as they go up in level is their ability to, you know, really effectively dual wield with two single-handed guns and get a bunch of shots with each. And so that was one of the things, one of the major things that the 6 dice cap was meant to address. And so by directly addressing dual wielding, it made it, you know, more comfortable to shift the dice cap to 8 instead of 6. So the change to dual wielding is that you still, if you dual wield with ranged weapons, this only applies to ranged attacks. If you dual wield with two ranged weapons, you still can't get critical hits, but you also have to choose which weapon is in your offhand, and the offhand weapon to hit rolls need to roll 1 higher than normal.
Oh, so that's cool. You
basically a -1 to hit with your offhand. So it's not like it completely, it's not like it completely nerfs dual wielding. It just scales it back a little bit, so it makes it more of a choice of whether it's worth using one gun that's going to get criticals and totally hit, or giving up your criticals to get more dice that might not hit.
Now, my Tredirin veteran wields his Lost Army musket in 2 hands and his Tredirin pistol in his tail. So what counts as an offhand for him?
So because it's still dual wielding, it would be the tail in that case would be the offhand.
Thank you.
So Jason,
So that's going to be in that revised rule book as well.
I fear that no one's going to tune in tomorrow night.
No one's going to what?
No one's going to tune in tomorrow night. You've already covered all of the.
Is there a schedule posted somewhere of all the lives?
Don't worry.
Hey, I'm waiting till tomorrow night to ask about the upgrade pack.
We
on their Facebook page.
Yeah, on our Facebook page, we posted the schedule for each of the days.
And I think it was also reposted onto the Shadows of Brimstone community group on Facebook as well. Yeah. Okay. Are all you guys on there on the community group?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, but I don't check in that often.
No. There's a Facebook group
every day.
How does
so? Will the FAQ be updated as well?
The FAQ will be updated. It'll come a little bit after the revised edition rulebooks come out. So that'll actually be the most up-to-date rulebook, and it'll be available for download as well. So everyone will have access to that updated rulebook as a PDF.
Good, because I didn't really want to buy the two sets again.
That's really cool. Right. It's really nice.
Yeah, it's really nice that you're putting out Swamps, because a lot of people on the group and Facebook have been asking, where can I buy Swamps? Where can I buy Swamps? And they've gotten into the game maybe through Forbidden Fortress, and now they want to go down the rabbit hole like the rest of us and buy everything. Right. So they've been asking, and it's good that you're putting out a new Swamps.
Well, you know, we're super aware of we're gamers ourselves, right? And nothing bugs me more than, you know, we cut our teeth on Games Workshop stuff, and there were many times where you'd buy like a brand new army and you'd have, you know, oh yes, my High Elf book came out and all the new models for it and everything. And then like, I swear 2 months later, they would be like, oh, the new set of the game and all
new edition.
Yeah. New edition and whatever. And we didn't, you know, we wanted to have some space between, the previous edition and the new one so that people didn't feel like I literally just bought Swamps of Death yesterday and now you have a revised edition. So when it went out of stock, we didn't restock it. Instead, we said, well, you know, let's wait and let it kind of taper off and then we'll do the revised sets because we don't want anybody to feel the pinch. And you know, besides that, it's not a whole new edition where it makes any of your stuff obsolete. And so we're going
to
put
I think what you're trying to say is it is completely compatible with all other expansions and all the enemy packs and the heroes and worlds and all of that. Like there's no fundamental changes that are so significant that it would make anything like that obsolete. It's more just tweaks and polish and working in the errata and rebalancing a few things, especially with those original Old West heroes and, you know, the elite charts on the enemies. I mean, one of the things that that we kind of learned through developing the game over the last 6 or 7 years since it's been released is, you know, making it that the elite charts are a little bit more significant in the impact that they have on how deadly the enemies are. You know, originally it was that the enemy stats were there and then the elite charts would make them a little bit worse, you know, a little bit nastier, but it was a little bit swingy, especially with those core set enemies. And so with the kind of rebalanced version of that, the main stats of the enemies haven't changed that much because they're already meant to be introductory enemies, but the elite charts definitely got upgraded to make them a little scarier. And so they still fully work with all of the trait packs and everything like that. That because those trait packs really make the basic monster stats scarier. But now when they're elite, if you're level 3, if you're level 4, if you're level 5, it means those elite abilities are gonna be a little bit scarier even still, which I think is kind of the sweet spot of what you want. And you'll also see that in a lot of the enemies that we've been releasing just over the last couple of years is that the main stats are not necessarily the scariest thing ever. Like they'll be challenging. But once they start getting elite abilities and combinations of elite abilities is where they start kind of kicking your butt.
But again,
same plans to, we have, to do this with other enemy sets. Will you go back to other previously released products and address elite abilities on those too?
Well, the ones that were the most affected by this are really the core set enemies because the outlook was always that the core set enemies are, at least for the two Old West core sets, are kind of the introductory enemies. And then the expansion enemies can be tougher because you're specifically playing more and adding more to the game to make it more dangerous, to make it more varied and more interesting. And so a lot of those, you know, virtually all of the expansion enemies have had that in mind from the beginning. Now, some of the ones that are 5 or 6 years old now, maybe it's not quite as extreme, but you know, one of the things we've found a lot with doing a lot of demos and playing a lot of games with new players, as well as existing players, is that it's good to have enemies of different difficulty levels so that you can specifically say, okay, you know, we're just starting out. We've got some new players. Maybe they've only played a couple times before. We'll put in the Masters of the Void. We'll put in the Darkstone Brutes. We'll put in the Harvesters or the Hell Vermin, those enemies that kind of came out within the first year of the game's release, because it allows you to make them a little bit less scary for new players and low-level heroes. If that makes sense to you guys.
So I do have a question about the new revised editions, and this is probably going to get answered fairly strongly during the... Cody, can you go take care of that? During the meet tomorrow, but since we're in the middle of a game tomorrow at that time, is there going to be some sort of like upgrade deck or something? I mean, you don't have to get into details now, obviously, since we're getting into those details tomorrow, but just like a more general idea. If not, I'm willing to buy new box sets.
Yeah, so we would definitely be fully addressing that tomorrow in the live stream. Everybody seems to be very on pins and needles over it, so I'll tell you right now, yes, there's going to be an upgrade kit.
Oh, awesome. Would that include, like, the new models?
No, the models are separate.
Tomorrow.
Yeah, we'll talk about it more track. Tomorrow.
Okay. I'm ready to go to show Odakuro stuff right now. I have the screen just waiting to show it. The other thing is that we're going to try to take this video and you know, put it up for other people who couldn't make it. And I'm going to feel really bad if it's about everything except for Forbidden Fortress.
Sure. Okay. So Odakuro, let's see it.
Here he is in all his glory with that burning character, kanji character on his head. Rising up from the ground, facing off against samurai and traveling monk.
Waving hi to some friend of his.
Yep. It's the other Odakuro across town.
Also, if you look there on the Tori gate, it actually has the kanji for gate, which I thought is pretty fantastic. The artist was like, I don't know any Japanese. Like, is there a kanji you want me to put on there? And I was looking at different ones, and I thought, you know what would be funny is to put gate. I think that would be
a little Easter egg.
Yeah.
That's the gate.
It's the gate. Either that or they're just really good at labeling things there. All right, so Jason.
Like Batman 66.
Talk Odakuro. Why don't we just skip right ahead and show the stats? Here we go. Look at this.
So the Odakuro is a pretty crazy XXL enemy. He actually is immobile because he's bursting out of the ground. So he can't really chase you around. But because of his ridiculously long arms and giant size, he has a pretty long reach. You can see there's a little chart on the side there in his abilities that shows his reach. And it also, he gets bonuses the further you are away from him. Like bonuses to his kind of defense. And so, you know, as you get close to him, he'll cause more terror, but he becomes easier to hurt.
Talk about piles of dead.
Yeah, he also has piles of dead that are churned up in the rubble that's in the ground where he comes out. And so he has actually a chance of spawning low threats as undead enemies that basically, he's previously consumed and is now and have now crawled up out of the earth where he's burst up out of to come out and attack you under his control.
All right.
So he ends up being a pretty scary enemy because you kind of need to get close to him to be able to realistically hurt him. But as you get closer, he becomes more and more terrifying. So his you know, horror hits become more significant as you get closer to him.
Now, let's say you're in the Forest of the Dead when you encounter him, and mm-hmm. you already have a dead, lost soul of a harvester from the Blasted Wastes in the deck, and he raises that lost soul. Now, would you draw as normal for the lost soul, or would you bring back the harvesters that you actually fought?
Well, generally, you would draw a new low threat card, but, you know, if you're feeling saucy and you want to have him bring back enemies that you just defeated, you certainly could, you know. I mean, one of the things about Shadows of Brimstone is it's very story-driven, and if something is going to make for a cooler story and a cooler adventure, the intent is that you should embrace it, you should do it, you should run with it, because that's what makes the game fun and memorable and exciting.
So I did have a question about the Oni Warlord.
Okay.
When the Swamp Raptor first came out, it had, of course, the one miniature in it, but the card stated that you could run into up to D3 of them. You were talking about how in one particular adventure, you could run into several of them.
So that's actually not the case. You only really are going to run into one Oni Warlord during an adventure. The
that was
the
me mission, making a joke. I'm sorry.
Yeah, the mission is to try and play the mission up to four times, hunting down each of the four Oni, the Yurei-Oni brothers.
Okay, so he was talking about the insane mode version.
Yeah, he was making a joke about the explosive barrels mission where you fight multiple epic threats at once, potentially, if you want to play the insane difficulty.
Well, I was just curious because we had, when that first came out, you got the card in the pack and you're like, oh, I guess I better buy two more of these. And I was just wondering if that had ever come up again as an issue.
There's a few enemies out there that have threat cards that let you fight multiple of them at once, like the Guardian of Targa or the Swamp Raptors, like you mentioned. We put those cards in there because, when we were doing development on those enemies, it seemed like it would be really fun. And, you know, it was kind of a fun and epic battle to actually have to face two of this giant creature, or up to three in the case of the Swamp Raptor. So it just made it more exciting and more fun. And, you know, it didn't make sense to sell them in multiple in a set because it's so rare that card comes up. So the question was, well, do we not put the card in and save it and put it out as like a promo card? Or do we go ahead and include it and just say, you know, if you want to use this card, it's a totally extra thing. But if you want to use it, you can get a second, Guardian of Targa. And then suddenly, if you want a real challenge, you can fight two of them at once. Or if you want a real challenge, you can fight up to three Swamp Raptors at once. So it was kind of just throwing it in there or including it as an extra. That would be fun for people that want that extra challenge. But it does, would require you to have multiple models for it where you only get one in the actual set. Now, with the Oni Warlord, there aren't any cards like that to fight multiple Oni Warlords because that would probably be overkill. They'd be stuffing your entire party into their slave cages and you'd be in real trouble pretty quick.
Fair enough. Okay, thank you.
Yep.
No, I think Gavin needs seven Oni Warlords.
Well, if you're going to paint them all different, then you would have at least the three different paint schemes. But if you want to have a group shot, you could have four of the albino brothers, the Yurei-Oni. But that would be a little bit overkill, perhaps.
All right, Jason, I've put up the cover of the Feudal Village here.
And, you have.
This cover art is actually done by Mr. Ralph Horsley. He's an illustrator in England who actually did the covers for Forbidden Fortress, both the Shadows of Brimstone original core sets, as well as things like Derelict Ship. He's really like the face of art for Shadows of Brimstone. So of course, with the Feudal Village, we wanted to go back and have him do it. And he just did a great job with this. Look at the terror. Terror on these villagers' faces. Look at, they're kicking over apples. This is horrible.
That's how you know they're dastardly.
That's right.
The guy in front is basically looking like he's just seen an Oni Warlord going, it's like, what the f-?
Exactly. all right, so if we go through here, there's some more art. This is actually one of the missions, right? What is this? Burn it to the ground, right?
This is Burn It to the Ground. It's one of the missions in the Feudal Village where basically there's torch-wielding bandits that are coming into the village and trying to burn it down all around you, and you're racing around trying to put out fires and stop them from burning, raising the village. Well, that ended up being kind of small, huh? So these are some of the village types. So much like the Frontier Town in the Feudal Village expansion, there are specific types of villages you can encounter. So this one is a monastery village where there's a big brotherhood temple that they're training at. And so it has special effects. This is you can run into a Takobake village, where it's controlled by the Takobake clan. You can see there's a lot more mutants and it's kind of militaristic. So obviously sneaking around there is going to be a little challenging.
You know, it's a Takobake village when this guy's like the normal one. he's just got a tentacle arm as opposed to, you know, all the Takobake.
Yeah.
All right, let's see.
This is the mountain village. So it's kind of more about mining, and it's up high in the mountains.
Looks too peaceful.
Yeah, this one is the Outlaw Haven. So you can see that it's kind of shady. It's similar to the Outlaw Town in the Frontier Town. And you can see there's assassins in the foreground hiding behind those barrels, waiting to jump out and attack someone.
This guy's moonwalking.
Yeah, clearly. So this just lets you see some of the images for those different ones. This is the Western Trading Post town. It's actually the trading port town, but it specifically has a Western Trading Post, which is one of the new locations.
Which were all Dutch.
Yeah, a lot of Dutch traders there.
You will have to play the gambling hall in one of the towns, right? For the one of the special locations with this Old West riverboat in one of the towns.
That was Apocalypse One?
Yes.
Yeah, the town of Armageddon. I think
it's Armageddon, yeah.
Yeah. Yep, with the fancy riverboat.
In the on the big, you know, the big map you included with Forbidden Fortress, there's also a conquistador's village or something on there. Is there tie in any way to adventures?
Yeah, well, sort of. One of the islands basically has an area where conquistadors have come up in search of Darkstone and have found a stable gateway to Jargono. That's kind of just a little bit of an Easter egg pointing at Brimstone Adventures and leaving an open thread that we could come back to.
Right. Okay. Yeah, you don't have to necessarily fill it right away.
Yeah, to have crossover between the feudal Japanese heroes and the conquistadors, because they do hit right at a very similar time period in history, for the Sengoku era in Japan, combined with the sort of conquistador expansion into Central America and South America.
This is here. You can see another mission image, and this one is for Honor Duel.
Yeah, so much like
High Noon.
Good night. So yeah, much like High Noon in the Frontier Town, you can actually get challenged to an honor duel in the feudal village, and so this is the image for that that solo mission that you can play.
There's still a Nobu slave village.
There is a Nobu slave village, actually.
Excellent.
We didn't show all of the village types. We just showed some.
Crab.
Well, this place looks like a fun place. Tengu and the Akamaki monsters, I think they're called.
Akaname.
Yeah, this is another mission. This is for Village Overrun.
Wait a minute, isn't that a slasher from the original box set?
It is.
Yeah, they go delicious with butter.
Took a wrong turn somewhere.
Well, remember those slashers are unspeakable horror, so they're from all across space and time.
Yeah, if there's a gate open, good chances a slasher may come through.
You know, you boil him up with some drawn butter. It's looking good.
Yeah, I think the Japanese villagers know how to take care of him.
Make some slasher sushi.
Exactly. This is a cool image, though. It really turned out great. Oh, look at this.
Okay, this is the map.
I believe this is the first time we've ever shown the tactical board for Forbidden
the village.
Fortress Feudal Village.
Yeah, so this is the colors are a little bit saturated because of it's being shown in CMYK, but this is the village map where the six different missions in the Feudal Village expansion take place. And so you can see there's a bunch of different buildings represented there, like a temple and a guardhouse. You can see there's a kind of torii gate at the front of the temple. And with this one, there's a lot more kind of back alleys and small twisting, turning pathways than you found on the Old West Frontier Town board. A lot of the areas are designed for getting into little melee skirmishes because Forbidden Fortress is so much more hand-to-hand based with swords and things of that nature.
Well, but just, you know, Western towns were built with, you know, like one main road, while Japanese villages were just kind of hodgepodge.
Yeah. And so also, it represents that a little better and gives you more of those back alleys to have your Seven Samurai type adventures in.
Also, Western towns were built around the fact that everybody at that time had horses and wagons, whereas mm-hmm. a few hundred years before in Japan, they weren't that common.
Right. And you can see this location, this building in the lower right there is the local samurai lord's house. And so
see, this is his giant pickle.
Yeah, that's like a little cushioned seat, but it does look a little bit like a pickle.
I probably have ruined it where now everyone will always think that that looks like a giant pickle. I'm sorry in advance.
Yeah, there's the bathhouse.
Yep. Pickle enemy confirmed.
Yeah.
Is that a swimming pool or a grand piano?
that's the bath in the bathhouse. Pickle Village.
Pickle Village.
I'm a Pickle Rick. I meant Morty.
Pickle Rick. Yeah.
And if you scroll up, you can see the swordsmith and swordsmith and the tavern with the little tea house area. And you can see up in the upper left is a magic shop. So it's kind of a shop of occult goods and magic artifacts that's kind of tucked away in the back of the village where the mystics hang out. So anyway, you can see another thing that's kind of interesting on this map is it actually has more enemy entry points than the frontier town did. So it's a little bit more varied where the different enemies will stream into the village from. In the frontier map, it had one on each of the edges, and this one has two on each of the long edges. Yeah, we'll have to do a promo Pickle Village village type at some point. So here you can see the Feudal Bandits enemy record sheet, and these guys, you can see their stats. They don't seem like they're that dangerous. Defense 3, health 3, combat 2, damage 2, they only hit on 4s. But their abilities there make them especially scary in big groups.
Yeah.
The gang up looks very nasty.
Combined with overwhelm.
The big yep. one is great.
Yeah, the big one is one of their lead abilities. The idea was that in any good samurai movie or a group of big thugs, there's always the one that steps out that's head and shoulders above the rest and super muscle bound, and he's the scary one you have to contend with. So it was fun to add in the elite ability where instead of boosting all of them, it takes one of them and makes him the big one.
I can't wait to get a shootout between a swordsman and a pistol-wielding, fedora-wearing cowboy.
Could be more deadly than you think.
I'm sensing a resin miniature for the big one.
Yeah, you never know. You never know.
How many bandits are going to come with this?
It has a set of 12 bandits.
Okay, good, cool.
12 feudal bandits, so they can really overwhelm you. And it's kind of cool because melee is so much more prevalent in Forbidden Fortress, having those 12 enemies means that they can spread out and be looting and pillaging while you're fighting, you know, still fighting several of them down a dark alley somewhere. So it really makes the missions more intense because you have to kind of decide, do I fight all these guys in the alley or do I break away and try to stop that guy who's trying to burn down a building or trying to, you know, knock over a market stand and steal a bunch of the goods to pillage the place. So here's just a few of the new locations, just to give you a little taste of it. So one of the new locations is the Samurai Lord. It's basically the local Samurai Lord that you can, he's one of the locations in town if you get this one. And so you can go and visit him. You might want to zoom out a little bit. That's a little extreme. But you can get different types of sake there. You can buy bombs. You can also get a warlord's bounty where he's put a bounty out on a particular enemy group by visiting him and kind of seeing what he wants hunted down. And if you spin onto the next page, I think it's the back of this one.
Hellfire sake, huh?
Yep. So when you go to the samurai lord, you can actually have an audience with the warlord where you can pay tribute. You can ask for war aid by making a lore test and seeing if he can help you out on your next adventure. You can also consult his court advisors, which actually lets you scavenge in town to get some potential bonuses. And if you're feeling especially dastardly and you're stealthy like an assassin, you could even attempt to assassinate the local samurai warlord and take him out as a hired assassination. It's also got stuff that soldier heroes can do there. So that would include the soldier hero class from Temple of Shadows, or the samurai warriors are also keyword soldier. So you can go get different helmet adornments. You can get a folded darkstone katana. You can go and march to war with the samurai lord's armies, get some extra experience. You can also refine your battle tactics and actually be able to swap out battle tactics by visiting the samurai lord. So there's a lot of cool variation that you can get in there for kind of respecking your samurai whenever you go to town, if they have the right locations.
Any chance that at some point we're actually going to see a card pack with like all the items from the feudal village, not to mention the old town at one point?
Yeah, we've talked in the past about, you know, we really want to do those packs. It's kind of a big investment of time and resources to make it happen, just because you don't really realize how many items there are in there until you start kind of breaking it down. And so, I mean, most people don't really realize how many items there are in there. And so when each item needs its own unique piece of art and its own card layout and all of that kind of thing, you know, it's something we want to do. We plan on doing it. The question is just when we'll actually have it ready. You never know. You never know. So here you can see the back of the tea house. And one of the goals with the tea house is that every time we would talk about how the tea house was one of the locations, everyone's first conclusion is, well, what am I going to do at the tea house? What, I'm just going to drink some tea? That doesn't sound very exciting. But you'll find that the tea house is actually one of the coolest places in the entire feudal village to go visit, because you can do tea ceremonies that give you bonuses on your upcoming adventure. You can actually order specialty teas that give you some serious bonuses as well. And you can, if you're a performer, you can actually give performances here. There's also a bunch of side bag tokens on the front side of this where you can get tea and bring it with you on your adventures things of that nature. So we wanted to make sure that the tea house was, you know, when you hear the sound of it, it doesn't sound as exciting. But once people actually have a chance to go there and utilize it for their heroes, I think it'll be very popular.
Okay, Uncle Iroh.
I'm looking forward to my gambler showing off his card tricks there.
That's right. That's the way to do it. Here you can see the backside of the Brotherhood Temple. So one of the things in the theme of Forbidden Fortress is there are the Yamabushi monks, who are basically a sacred order of monks that live up in the mountains and are dedicated to fighting mythological creatures of legend and folklore, and were more or less wiped out by the return of Shoryu, the Dragon King. And so the heroes that play Yamabushi monks are kind of a dying breed. They're the last of their sacred order traveling the roads to try and fight off these massive evils. The Brotherhood monks are more commoners who have taken on a role of being warrior monks to defend local villages and to train in martial arts and archery and things of that nature. So the Brotherhood Temple, when you can visit that in town, has a lot of things that kind of reflect that. You can go to the temple courtyard there and train with the Brotherhood. And so when you do that, you earn these Brotherhood training points that you get from mission to mission. And if you collect those up over multiple visits, you can actually trade them in to get ever increasing bonuses based on how many you have. So you can trade them in after just one adventure or two adventures in town, you know, going and training at the village to get some smaller bonuses, like next adventure, your critical hits are +1 damage, or you can remove a madness or injury, or you can save them up and get much more impressive bonuses further down the line. The other thing is you can do trials to become part of the Brotherhood. And so there's four different trials that you can do, and you have to do them sequentially. So you can start out doing the initiate trial, and if you pass that one on a future visit, you can come back and try to do the monkey trial, then eventually the serpent trial, and finally the dragon trial. And each one of those gives you permanent bonuses, but you have to use your training markers to be able to get those bonuses. So it's a lot of cool stuff worked into that theme of the warrior monks, kind of the commoners coming together to try to help fight off the darkness.
I spotted one thing on there. The sharpen your weapons might need rewording, might need a narrator. Because the way I'm reading that, I could sharpen my guns. It's...
combat hits, maybe not ranged hits.
Yeah, it says your combat hits.
Ah, yeah, it does. Never mind.
But my sumo could sharpen his fists.
Well, you could sharpen what is the lost arm need?
Yeah, the bayonet on your on your hell musket.
Yeah, that's sense. A combat hit. That's not a ranged hit.
Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be all right.
If you're talking about your sumo fists. Just imagine that you're sharpening your cunning in how you strike with your fists.
You got something sharp that you put on something that wears off.
After or you sharpen the calluses on your fists.
So Jason, we're just about to hit the end of this, and I'd love to have a few minutes just to chat with people too.
Okay.
Were there just a couple more things you wanted to?
I mean, if you want to spin through these a little bit faster, I mean, there's a deck of daily events, much like the Frontier Town daily events. So I just had a couple of samples of those thrown in there that, you know, add some exciting stuff. An undead uprising can happen.
It's a thing.
Or a cherry blossoms blowing in the wind. Here's a couple of the village types. Somebody asked about an enslaved Nobu village earlier. This is something that you can run into. And one of the cool things in the enslaved village is you can actually attempt to start an uprising and try to get the local people to throw off their shackles and kick the Nobu taskmasters out of their village. So kind of similar to the haunted village or the haunted town in
Feudal Village.
In the original Frontier Town, where you can try to go on a mission to break the curse. This one is all within the context of the village, but it lets you try to lead an uprising potentially. The trading port, where you can see coastal travel and the different, the non-bond trade routes of the time. There's the Takobake village, which has mutant specialists. The last one there you'll see is a little bit of a surprise. So one of the missions in the Feudal Village expansion is called the Dark Well. And it is based off of the Onryo myths of feudal Japan, which you may be familiar with for a lot of popular movies in the last decade or so, like The Ring or The Grudge. Those are all based.
Have you ever seen Ringo?
Or Ringu, yeah.
The original Japanese one? That's terrifying.
Yeah. So the Onryo is what those movies, the mythology that those movies are based off of, the folklore. And so in this Dark Well mission, basically, there is this water spirit down at the bottom of the well who shatters the boarded over top of the well and comes out as a giant Harinago that is looking for revenge on the village. And so you're basically running around the village trying to find artifacts from her former life to scare her and force her back into the well before she consumes all of the villagers in her vengeance. So it's a pretty cool mission, and it gives a new trait card for the Harinago that you can use anytime, but specifically also with this Dark Well mission.
All right, so that wraps up the preview there.
This is really cool stuff.
Yeah, pretty.
Thanks, guys, those look amazing.
I am very excited.
I hope nobody's heads are spinning. That was quite a lot of information in a short amount of time. It was like a brain dump.
Here comes the
question. We love it. We'll take
You've got all of these amazing new stuff and a lot of very powerful stuff. How close are you guys to coming up with a scheme to go beyond level 8 for the heroes?
Oh, you're not putting beyond level 8? Oh, man, it gets so much better. Man, my level 12 samurai is awesome.
All we can really say to that is no comment at this time.
Okay.
Interesting.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's something we've you know, I've worked on developing a little bit, but you know, it's still relatively early on with it. We want to make sure that it's not something that's gonna break everything, you know, because you know, by doing it initially to have that level cap of 8, it encourages people to make new heroes and to be constantly trying out new builds and whatnot. It's very easy for heroes that get kind of you know, higher level to get kind of in a power creep rut. And so like by the time you reach level 8, your hero is kind of a superhero who can go around and kick a lot of butt. And that's cool because it feels really powerful, but it also means that to go beyond level 8, you know, you definitely need a lot of stuff that's going to challenge your hero and turn some things that you think you know on its ear.
No, I understand. The balance issues would be significant, but I'm looking at the Oni Warlords and I'm thinking, I don't, even a party of, let's say a party of 2 or 3 level 7s is going to be hard pressed against some of that stuff he's going to pull in.
Well, we try to keep it challenging. But what I was going to say is, you know, our style has always been to make games wide rather than long. And so by that, I mean, there's a lot of variety. There's all these different types of characters you can play and they're all balanced. There's all these different worlds you can visit. There's all these different missions you can play, all these different enemies you can fight, all these different allies you can get. And so the idea is it feels like a giant world. It's very wide. It's not like long. And part of the cap.
The point of that is that you're not trying to add everything in the kitchen sink in every session. It's more like you decide the pieces or you randomly get the pieces that you're going to be using in any given session. And the more stuff you have, the more variety you have, rather than having to squeeze everything into one session where it becomes so complex and so weighty that it's difficult to even play.
I'm just curious. It's an idea because, you know, I just see all these great, super high-end stuff and like it is kind of sometimes tough to find a big group. I often play with one other person or solo playing two characters. And so I'm like often overwhelmed by even the more basic stuff. So, okay. Just an idea. Just a question idea.
Oh, absolutely. It's something we've talked about and something that Jason's been working on for a while, but I guess I just wanted to point out that it's one of those things where, you know, sometimes it's about the journey and not the destination. And a lot of the fun of playing we've found through literally years and years of playtesting is that, like, trying out a different character class and you know, what happens with this one? And because you can get really entrenched and you're one class and you've got your super boots and you've got your fantastic guns and your mega build out and whatever. And there is a certain amount of fun to that, but it can be so rewarding to step outside that and play a totally different character type and get, you just experience things in a completely different way. And so one nice thing about having the cap is that people will hit that and then start new characters and then get to see things, you know, whole different experiences. So
great.
So we like that about the way it is currently.
One of the things we do is we play multiple groups, like every other adventure, we switch different heroes we're using for different groups. And actually one of the things we just started was, and we're actually, I wanted to ask, so you have the cards to make a hero become a vampire, a werewolf, or a zombie. And we actually started a group. We have 4 heroes we're playing. And one is a werewolf, one is a vampire, one is a zombie right off the bat.
Now, let me stop you here. I know where this is going. You want to be a Frankenstein. Is that correct?
We just want one more. We just need one more.
We need one more so we can have a full party of 4 different cursed heroes.
Yeah.
You can do
well, you'll have to wait and see how that comes about.
Cursed Eternal from Adventures is coming up.
So I got 3 questions I could ask real quick. Is that all right?
Absolutely.
Okay, the first question is, so I bought some of those extra products on the Kickstarter, and after seeing your presentation, I really want to add a couple more. Is that still possible?
So possibly. That's the short answer. The longer answer is, you know, we've already put in like the manufacturing numbers based on the orders. So we're not really able to open the floodgates. Like, let's just post it up and have everybody do that. But, you know, if there were a few people that were to contact us and email admin@flyingfrog.net and let us know, I think we could probably take care of you.
Okay, that would probably be me.
Okay.
Second thing, I'm really looking to get some of the blank cards for the Forbidden Fortress sets, like Belly of the Beast, Forest of the Dead.
Right.
I use those a lot. And are you going to be planning on making those anytime soon?
Great to hear feedback about that. The blank cards are something where we, from the very get-go, we're like, well, we have to have blank cards, especially like threats, so people could make their own monsters or, you know, take models that they have from other games that they love and make stats for them and then have them appear in the game. And it's really important to have the real cards so that you can write on the front, and that's fine, but the back is the real card back, so it just shuffles right in with your other deck. And so so it was really important to us. Once we actually put it out there, it's questionable how much people care about it. I mean, we've had it at conventions and people are like, oh, look at this, look at that. And we're like, and look, blank cards. And people are going, tell me again about derelict ship. And we're like, no, blank cards. And so it's tough for us to gauge, but it's great to hear from somebody who actually feels like we do, where it's really cool to be able to add your own stuff to the game and uses those blank cards.
And what I do a lot is I take the blank threat cards from like Cinder, I mix them in, and if I wanted to do a mission with like the werewolves, I would just, if you pull up the blank card, then you get werewolves, and I do that a lot. And
so kind of proxy. And
when I'm playing Belly of the Beast, it's like there's no random other things popping up there, and it kind of
right.
makes me sad.
Right. Well,
good idea.
I think it's definitely something that we could do. And, you know, this just adds a little bit more fire under it.
Okay, and then my final question is, it's not a question. I've been Kickstarter backer all three so far. And I love Forbidden Fortress. My kids love it. Since we got that, we have not played a single Western character at all. Except the gambler once, and that's pretty fun. So I'm certainly hoping that, you know, you do more Japanese themed sets, monsters and worlds, because I love that stuff.
Oh, fantastic. Have you played through the different Temple of Shadows hero classes?
Yes, we've gone through almost all of them except for the sumo wrestler. That's the last one.
Ah. What about the traditional Japanese Tredarin veteran?
That guy is a lot of fun, and no, he's on a hiatus right now. he got a little bit too powerful.
Yeah, you send him back to Tradera?
He was hanging out with the Kitsune, and the Kitsune would just never get any experience points. He'd kill everything. So I was like, maybe it's time to give him a rest and then bring him back when other characters get up to his level.
Well, you know what it sounds like you need is an entire Tredaran strike team to use.
Oh, there you go.
You guys should get right on that, because I've already
paid for a tank.
Yeah.
And a tank for them to drive.
That is the single best thing. Like, when you guys showed that on the Kickstarter that we were going to get a tank with that.
Yeah.
I was kind of hoping for a walker, but a tank's the second best. What?
I'm hoping we get a threat for two tanks.
Yes. There's going to be that card for two tanks. And there will be the different colored tanks. Well, this is a red tank. That way it goes
different fast. Loadouts.
There's one kind of fiction rule I was hoping to ask about.
Sure, go ahead.
The card for the Nuri Oni, it says that when you draw their tribal card, you keep it for the rest of the adventure. But in the rule book, it says you discard it once you're done fighting. Which one is it supposed to be?
Do you know what you're talking about, Jason?
For the Nurion, I'd have to go back and check out the specifics on it. I don't recall off the top of my head. I know it's only day one of Gen Con Online. That doesn't mean that it's any less exhausting.
Also, I should say, just in case we didn't finish answering the previous question, you know, we do intend to do more Japanese heroes in the future. One thing that I would suggest, if you haven't checked it out yet, we actually have a wandering samurai that was originally done as an Old West character, but he's pretty cool, actually, as a different type of samurai player character.
Every time I've presented that to my players, they're like, nah, we want the real thing. I'm like, come on.
Has anybody done a baby cart assassin yet?
A which?
A baby cart assassin.
A baby cart assassin.
Yeah, have you not heard of that? Lone Wolf and Cub.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Okay.
Yeah. Has anybody done one yet? Like even the fans?
Yeah, I haven't seen that, but I'm actually, now that you mention it, I'm amazed that no one has modeled that to go with their samurai, especially.
I've been putting one together, but I haven't posted it or anything like that.
So, oh yeah.
Hey, you just run a 2-player hero party of an orphan and a samurai, and just use the baby as the orphan.
Even better, here's what you do: you get a samurai with a child of the void, right? Yeah. Lone wolf and baby.
No, I made a baby card as an ally that as far as a lone wolf cub is concerned.
Oh, we need a void child sword for the feudal village.
did anybody see the mutation sprues that we put out?
Yes.
We actually have two, not one, but two different Child of the Void models, and it was really important to us that they could go on to any that they could go onto any model. So we model them, because at first the idea started as, well, we should do a hero that has a Child of the Void. And then we thought, well, what if we actually just did a Child of the Void? And so so people could put it on anything. Let me see if I can find it real quick.
That's really cool.
What's your question?
My friend.
Yeah, I've wondered how you manage that.
Mm. I had a question more to do with the Wild West stuff. Is there any plans to do bandits with rifles?
You mean as miniatures?
That would be wonderful. Yeah. Maybe we'd like some cards and rolls to make it more fun as an expansion than just miniatures, but...
I think that the answer to that would probably be not that we've announced yet.
Mm-hmm. You do have a bit on your plate, but... You know, I'm sure that's room.
I do have another question along the lines of more Japanese heroes. Is there, like, you guys have some ideas of, like, what heroes that you were thinking about for originally with Forbidden Fortress, but then, you know, kind of went at the end, well, we're not going to be able to do this one, you know, this one or this one's cooler. Is there any heroes that kind of didn't make the cut?
There were a lot of different... classic kind of archetypes that, you know, we had talked about possibly doing. Kind of one of the runners up that I think would have been fun and might be fun in the future is to do the sort of blind monk archetype, because that's a pretty classic amongst samurai movies and, you know, Zatoichi, things of that nature. So I think that would have been, would potentially be at some point a pretty fun class to dive into, because it gives you a very different kind of style of how they might play out.
A blind monk could almost sound like a drifter almost level class for,
Fortress. I mean, maybe it would be the masseuse class, but they just happen to be the, you know, the kick butt blind monk.
Any other ones?
That was one of the ones that I always thought would be kind of cool just off the top of my head. You know, we had talked about a lot of different potential ones, but nothing else jumps out straight out of the gate as something that was close, but didn't make it.
Speaking of something that's been announced, well, not announced, but bounced around for years, Hell Train.
The impossible Hell Train.
You're never going to not get through something without someone asking that.
Yeah, well,
I'm just curious. I mean, I'm not that excited for it. It seems like a cool idea, but I'm just, boy, it's been bounced around so much. What?
I guess I said you're not excited about the Hell Train. I guess we won't do it then.
I'm going to have a hell train, but it'd just be interesting. I'm just curious as to where your thinking is with it. See, I'm not even sure how this got started. Was this something you proposed or is this some fans came up with and they kind of like roped you into it?
In the first Kickstarter, we were feeling our way through it. And partway through, we thought, we were studying what other Kickstarters did. We really did not know that much about it and how to do a Kickstarter.
It was pretty early on in the life of Kickstarter.
It was very early on in Kickstarters. And one of the things that we saw that some people were doing was having like this far off, seemingly unattainable goal, but yet, hey, you never know. Like if it reaches this crazy amount, then sure, all bets are off. Let's do it. And we thought, well, what's something that we could put out there? What if we did this hell train and it could be almost another whole game. It's like, you know, playing Shadows of Brimstone Adventures on a train. And then, you know, this idea expanded. And of course you'd have mounted heroes on horseback. You'd have characters in stagecoaches. And you'd have, bandits and scenarios where you could rob trains and then the train cars, you know, you can not only move around in the train cars, but they have a flip side, which is like demon world train cars. And like, it's really cool, but it's huge. And so the thought was, well, let's put it up as like a far off stretch goal that we...
$2 million.
Yeah, so we put it as like a $2 million thing. And then we named it The Impossible Hell Train, meaning it's no way, it's never going to happen. And so it was nice as a far off, you never know. Unfortunately, people are like, you already said it, no take backs. and yet it's a massive undertaking for the way we would want to do it. So it's not something, you know, so far we've been pretty packed with things to do, you know, a full roster of stuff to satisfy the demands of the Kickstarters we've done, and of course the new surprises that we show in each pledge manager, and on we go. So we've just created a cycle where we always feel like we're behind.
Feels like Hell Train might need to be a Kickstarter.
It's possible. Yeah.
You never know.
Well, if you actually did it, then what would we bug you about?
True. Well, we would have to have some far-off stretch goal for the Hell Train Kickstarter, and then people would just bug us about that.
Well, I have to bug you about more Fortune and Glory stuff.
Yeah.
Hey, I cornered you last Gen Con. You and me and my other friend talked for about half an hour.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I don't know if you remember, big guy. And anyway, and you said, oh, yeah, we got all this stuff coming for Fortune and Glory.
Yeah, we do.
Yeah, okay.
The statement is still true.
I really, really, really love that the Spider Queen is one of the spider demons from Forbidden Fortress.
Jorgumo.
Yeah, I love that so much. It's so great, the connection there.
It's all connected.
Well, she escaped Japan.
Well, we're running short on time. We're actually over by about 13 minutes, but I wanted to make sure in every group like this, in every gathering, there's always, you know, that person in the back that has something to say, but maybe never gets to talk. And I wanted to check in with some of those people. I see a lot of faces and names here I recognize, and I want to check in with them and see how they're doing. Like, I see Jim Robinson. Jim Robinson, how are you? Oh, he's muted.
I'm good, Scott. Thanks. I'm sort of disappointed that there's not going to be a Dice Fest this year. I've been to all of them, but I understand why it's not going to happen.
And we're going to do an online version.
Yeah, I saw that. I like to see the people, but I guess we'll get to see people on Zoom and that, so it'll be good. But
you think you're disappointed. Elian has spent several months building an amazing new 3D table, best one we've ever made for the Forest of the Dead. And it is so cool, and no one is going to see it. I mean, maybe we can show it virtually first, and then it'll debut in person in 2021. But it is really, really cool, and we're so sad. We couldn't wait to reveal this to the world. So we'll see.
Well, we'll reveal it virtually at Dice Fest Online.
I just wish Dice Fest was a little bit more centrally located. not for this year, obviously, because it's online, but, you know, in past and future.
Yes.
You mean like in Australia?
Well, yeah. That's hey, that would be a great trip to combine.
Sounds reasonable. Yeah,
I'm happy with it. It's 10 minutes from my house.
Once we start doing Dice Fest Australia, it'll be great.
So let's see. I also see a man in the derelict ship, Keith Shearer. I don't know if I'm saying your last name right. You've been here since the beginning, but haven't said anything. How are you doing, sir?
I'm fine. Wanted to thank you guys for putting those games together. I played one today, and I'm going to play a few more throughout the weekend. It worked out very well. I was pleased at how it went. So.
Well, that's fantastic.
And definitely looking forward to more stuff coming out. And, you know, it's a waiting game, but it's always worth it. So, thanks.
Well, very cool. Thank you very much. And I see you're using the one of the virtual backgrounds we made. We did that because we thought it would be kind of fun for players in our Zoom games, you know, our virtual game events. So,
How do you get those backgrounds?
What's that?
How do you get those backgrounds?
So if you play in one of the games, I send them to you, and it's a different one per game, and then you can set it in Zoom. You can set a virtual background like I have with this ice cave from Fortune and Glory.
What? You're not in the ice cave?
I know. Well, I wish I was because I'm sweating. It's pretty hot here.
It's actually in Cinder.
Yes, exactly. I'm in Cinder, but it looks like an ice cave. Here, just a second. Maybe I can make it more. Here we go. There we go.
There you go.
There we go. All right. So let's see who else. I see Josh Ellinghaus. He's uncharacteristically quiet.
Well, I got here late, so I didn't want to, like, suppose.
You snuck in?
I'm sure all my questions have been asked already. I'll get the scoop from Brendan later. I don't have to take up your valuable time.
All right. But everything's going okay?
Yeah. I work from home, like, my entire life, so it's not really that much different, actually.
All right. All right. Well, I'm just checking in with a few people that we haven't heard from. What about Madeline? I see her there. She's been here from the beginning, but hasn't said a word.
Hi, it's good to see you guys.
It's nice to see you. I wish we were on a show floor in Indiana right now.
Me too.
No
mostly
kidding.
Because there's air conditioning. No, I actually really miss not being at Gen Con. It's, you know, usually we think about it, talk about it all year long. And everything is just kind of geared toward Gen Con. So not having it, it's like in National Lampoon's Vacation where they drive across the country and find out Wally World is closed.
Yeah.
It's like we finally get to July and there's no Gen Con. It's craziness.
You guys think it's bad?
It's she looks at pictures of you guys and she can recognize. She sees you and she says, "It's Scott."
Wow. That's crazy. But
like
cool.
Your music stuff with Mary Beth.
Oh, very cool.
Yeah.
I just want to say it's one step.
I was supposed to be coming to Gen Con for the first time.
Oh,
and,
Oh, man, that sucks.
COVID happened. First time I would have left the country, too, so.
Oh, wow. Well, I hope you can join us for next year.
I'm hoping, yeah. Yeah, depending on the cost of flights. But, yeah, I was keen as.
Yeah.
Devoed. Absolutely devoed.
Well, you got to wait until it's safe. I mean, it's a strange time we're in right now. It really is. But it would be great to see you in person.
I think me and my brother are just about as bad with you in Australia. The thing is, we were really excited about this year's Gen Con because today, which is when Gen Con would open, is our birthday.
Oh, wow.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Yes, happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
So we were like,
don't ask us
birthday.
To say.
Yeah.
Only to you, not your brother.
Well, he's talking to my sister. We're ordering dinner.
All right. You can tell him happy birthday when he comes back.
Yeah. That's what really sucked for us was the next time he'll be on our birthday is the 2026.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I like that you've already calculated that. It's a little scary. All right. Let's see. Who haven't we heard from? How about Adrian Faulkner? How are you doing?
Hi there. Can you hear me okay?
We can.
Excellent. Excellent. Yeah, it's 3 o'clock in the morning here, so I'm about, if I fall asleep, it's nothing personal.
Well, I'm sorry to hear we kept you up all night, but hopefully the previews of stuff was worth the
while. Yeah, I'm really excited. As I say, I keep needing a checklist because every time something new comes out, I'm going, did I order this? Is this something that's coming in the next wave or something like that? So,
Wow. Well, you know what? One thing that we're doing, so when we were planning different events and all these things, live streams, games, demos, all that for Gen Con Online, we thought, you know what's too bad is in our store, in our booth at Gen Con, every year, there's people that come and they only know us from Gen Con. It's very strange. And they'll say, okay, I was here last year and I bought this game, Shadows of Brimstone, it's called. And I was just wondering, is there anything else for that beyond the core set?
and so
we thought it would be cool to have like a virtual store booth, you know, virtual booth store, and so we set that up. So for like 8 hours a day each day of Gen Con, we have this virtual booth store where we just, it's an ongoing Zoom call, and you can call in, and we have the guy who's the head of our web store is there. And he's just talking to people, answering questions. He can go through it like, oh, that's something that we released 2 years ago at Gen Con. This is something that was in the Kickstarter. And he can help you out with those things. So
cool.
You can find a link to that on our Facebook page.
Yeah, I did see that. I've just got to work out what I've already bought. I literally went through all my email receipts to go, right, what was it I've bought? What have I? Because
Yeah.
The worst thing is I'm terrible for gluing stuff together because I'm not a natural model maker. So literally today, I have just started on Forbidden Fortress I still haven't completed all the Minecraft stuff.
Wow. And you started with the dragon?
I thought I'd get the hardest one out the way.
I literally
was sitting here this afternoon just holding it together, just like watching stuff on Netflix.
You started with the correct one. It's the first one I put together.
Yeah, I thought get that one out of the way.
That's fantastic. Well, it's good to hear from you.
Cool.
Let's see if there's some other faces here. I see August. I know it's only July, but you're going to be around in a day or two.
I'll be still here in a couple days, yes.
How are you doing?
I'm doing awesome.
That's fantastic. Where are you calling from?
Michigan.
Oh, it looks like
it's when we go to Dice there. Fest. What's that?
Is it still light in Michigan?
No, that's a backlit.
Okay.
I took over my wife's carryall cabinet.
Oh, okay. It actually looks like
you're in there. It looks like you should recognize them
or something. Oh, I see. Yeah. Well, thanks for joining us for this Kickstarter backer meetup. Just to hit a couple more people. Let's see, Thomas White, you've been here waiting patiently. How are things?
They're pretty all right. I'm pretty excited to hear from you guys during all this Gen Con. This is the only Gen Con I've ever gotten to go to. So.
Oh, really?
And normally I just save up all my questions for bugging you guys at Dice Fest. So this means I get two in 1 year, right? It's great.
Oh, all right. Did you have one in the chamber, like some question for us?
No, I feel like actually most of them have been answered, including the one about the upgrade kit. So I'm pretty excited. Okay. I guess the only question I have, is there going to be any sort of adventures preview like this where you talk about the upcoming stuff, or is it still too far down the pipe?
No, it absolutely is. It's scheduled for Saturday at 7 p.m. Eastern time.
Oh, okay.
It's not going to be on Zoom. It's going to be
a live stream.
Facebook live stream. Just go to the Facebook, our Flying Frog Facebook page, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on Saturday.
Right, we probably won't be showing off quite as much. Most of what we'll show off will probably be artwork and miniatures and things like that, rather than full-on rules on stuff, just because the stuff is still in development. And so we tend to, for the most part, avoid showing off too much of that stuff too early. But we definitely have some cool artwork to show and some cool miniatures to show, and a lot of stuff to talk about.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Look forward to that then.
All right, what about Blue Kabuto?
Jeez, look at that. You calling me guys right away here. Yeah, Brian Kowalski from Blue Kabuto Games. I am a publisher and a game designer myself, so it's always nice to interact with someone else in the industry here. Quick question.
Sure.
Did you guys have a Japanese consultant with you to work on this? Just because a lot of times when Japanese games come out, either they're not, the names aren't spelled correctly, or you know, the culture is wrong and so forth like that.
Right.
Just curious.
We didn't, but it's kind of a hobby for a lot of us. Both Jason and I studied Japanese as a foreign language in high school and college.
Bikurishita. Nihongo hanashimasu ka?
It's not great.
No. Oh, okay.
One of my favorite phrases is "aishiteru kedo kikkon ga dekinai," which means "I love you, but I cannot marry you."
Yeah, they can't marry you. Yes, yes.
Sorry.
Well, that one gets much use.
But I wanted to say thank you very much. Your game is great. Unfortunately, I didn't back everything. Like the feudal village and so forth like that. So I think maybe I might send you a little message at the end and see if I can get,
email admin@flyingfrog.net and we'll see what we can do to sneak you under the wire there.
Okay. That's great.
All right. Well, great to hear from you.
Thank you.
Brian Suve, how are you? I see you unveiled your collection, which you had wrapped in plastic. Is it hermetically sealed to survive the apocalyptic COVID-19?
My wife and I decided to do the kitchen for this year of all years. We decided to remodel a kitchen. And my collection is in the basement, so everything was under wraps so that the dust and the falling stuff didn't ruin it. So I was... thought, gee, I got a whole audience to see. I should put it out in display.
That's awesome.
Yep. I'm really missing the Frog family this year. Say hi to Carol and Mary Beth and Sharon and Rolf and Chris and everybody for me.
Yeah, I think everybody really misses it. There's a lot of camaraderie and it's a great time every year at Gen Con. And it's such a great opportunity to see all of you guys. It really pumps us up for the entire year. And so we're missing that. I don't know. I don't know if we're going to be able to develop anything this year without being pumped up. It's a good thing we're doing events like this.
Hopefully Zoom helps.
Oh, yeah. So let's see. What about Zox? Z-O-X-E. I'm not sure how to say it.
That's Zox. Yeah. Good Zox. Evening. I'm doing well. Doing well. Played Derelict Ship earlier today, and that all went well. It was my first time playing via Zoom. So that was... An adventure in more ways than one. But yeah, all's well, enjoying it. I guess I'm glad I'm not the only person with the list to figure out what I have and don't have.
Believe it or not, we didn't set out to make it difficult. It just, man, between the Kickstarters and the different phases and the waves and the wave 1.5.
Pledge managers.
it can definitely be a little tricky.
For me, it's the supplement packs. They always get me, and so that's my quick list when the web store is updated. So, all's well. Appreciate it, and looking forward to play. Or actually, I'm playing again tomorrow. So,
fantastic! And if anybody's interested in playing in any of these events, we're doing them over Zoom. We weren't sure at first how we were going to do ticketing or whatever, like a way that people could sign up. And our sculptor, Daniel, said, hey, what if we did it through the web store? Which sounds crazy. At first, I was like, web store? What? And then I thought, there's nothing. I mean, if we didn't charge for it, it could be an item that costs $0. We could put in a quantity, which is the number of spots. We could even display the quantity so you can see, there's like 3 out of 4 spots available, And so it ended up working really well. So what you can do is, if you have any interest, we still have open slots in a lot of the games over the next 3 days. So you can go and look at the schedule first on we're putting it on Facebook. And so you can see on Facebook the schedule of all 4 days. It's about 3 or 4 posts down at this point. and then go to the web store, and we actually have a category that's called Gen Con Online, and you can click that, and it has all 4 days, and then you can just search based on the day and say, okay, I want to see Friday, and then look at them, and it'll show which ones are sold out or which ones still have slots. You just put it in your cart. It costs $0. You check out. And then that lets us know you are now signed up for that. So then we send out an email to you and it says, here's your Zoom ID number and the password. Here's the character you're playing. And it's already pre-chosen their starting upgrades and their starting gear and personal item and all that stuff. The stuff that usually takes the first like 20 minutes of each game, it's out of the way. So you just have it, you show up. All you need is some six-sided dice so you can chuck them and you're good to go. We even have been sending people virtual backgrounds. Like you can see Zox has the one from the derelict ship. And you can set that so that it puts you in the theme when you play the game. So I encourage you guys to check it out. It's a lot of fun. And like I said, we have slots available in our sessions for the next 3 days.
Yeah, all right. Do you plan to do like this?
Go ahead, Jim.
I just had a question. Is there any way to watch those games on Zoom, or is it just for the participants?
Right now, there is not, but we're going to try to record some of the sessions and see if maybe we can put them together so that we can post them on YouTube and have, you know, have a thing where later on people could watch and see how they go. One of the problems is that there's nothing standard about it. You know, it's run through Zoom. It's on a bunch of cameras, and people aren't even in the same room. So as far, you know, we always worry like, well, if we put this out, people are going to probably take this as like, oh, well, this is directly from the frogs. So this is going to be gospel. This is like the way to play or whatever. And so that's our only concern. But other than that, you know, it's good fun.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
I hope that makes sense. Any last minute questions before we call it a night?
Well, I got a question. Oh, go ahead.
I just wanted to say that labeling those new card packs as new for this sale was wonderful.
Oh, fantastic.
Very good.
Yeah, but you only put out two, so I can't take advantage of the discount because I have every other supplement pack. You have to put them
where
out.
Where is that? Pretty.
Get another growing dread pack. You'll need it for your other box.
That's true. Or get some blank cards. Actually, I don't know if the blank cards are in there now that I think about it.
Yeah, they are.
Are they?
Yeah, they're actually in there, yeah. Town blank cards would be good, yes.
Mm-hmm. All right.
So when you guys do Dice Fest, are you going to do it similar to how you did these this year for Gen Con?
Well, this is the first time we're doing this. And so already we've seen some things where we're like, this is working really well. We should lean into this. And this could be better. So when we do this next time, i.e. Dice Fest, we should change it this way. And so even though it's just been the first day of Gen Con Online, we're learning a lot. And so that's going to go into making Dice Fest even smoother and more fun.
Will you be able to run more games then? Because it's always a fight trying to get into the games.
That's true. It's just tough because like the several of the game sessions today we're running, like the 3D table, I think had 5 cameras, sometimes 6 when he put on his action cam. And so it's kind of brutal because we need an actual like phone or tablet for every single one of the cameras. So it can get pretty pricey just to outfit this. You know, it was a massive investment. We were just buying, you know, almost bulk tablets and devices so that we could cover all the angles and everything. But we were able to get it where we have a pretty full roster of a schedule of events. Dice Fest, usually we have a ton of tables and everything. I don't think we'll come nearly as close to like the number of tables we would have at a normal Dice Fest, but we'll do our best to try to have, you know, as many as we can without sacrificing the quality.
Would it be possible to get a photo of, say, how the cameras are set up? Because we're in lockdown again, right. God knows how long. So I thought about maybe trying to do set up for my guys. I have a lot of tech gear already, so.
Sure. Well, what we, you know, our idea behind it anyway, is that, you know, we have one device that's your main communication device, and you want that to be the biggest screen possible. So that's usually like going to be a PC or a laptop, maybe a iPod Pro or iPad Pro or something like that. It's a pretty big screen. And that one is going to be showing you so that you can talk to them and you can see them. So that's your interfacing back and forth. That also is where you're admitting people and letting them into the Zoom call. So that's like the hub of communication. And then we have other things call into that. So that main one is like the host who starts the call. The other ones that call in, we figured you definitely need to have an overhead camera. So we've been getting, you can get mounts that go on to, they clamp onto something. It could clamp onto a table or something like that. But we've found that it works really well to have either mic stands or tripods. And so we'll clamp those on and then have an overhead view aimed straight down. It's pulled back enough that all it gives you is a general sense of here's the whole board and here's where I'm at. But you can't really see things like the results of dice rolls or cards or even specifics about the miniatures. So that's pretty pulled back. And then the third one for kind of the minimum setup is going to be a close-up view. And we usually set that as like a three-quarter view of just kind of the room that you're on or the part of the board that you're on. And that way it also shows off the miniatures. You can tell who's who and what's what. And we try to roll dice in front of that camera so you can see the results. So that's basically the bare minimum for a setup. And once you have that, you can pretty easily play Shadows of Brimstone or Forbidden Fortress or a number of our games, you know, over Zoom, and it works pretty well. All right.
Thank you.
All right. Well, I think we're probably just about out of time here. We've gone over by, I think, 37 minutes now.
Yes, but I wanted to end by saying, you know, anytime we get to talk to people that backed us in the Kickstarter, you know, at conventions or in updates or any place, we really want to make sure we take the opportunity to thank people. You know, thank you so much for your support and the community that's grown up around the Kickstarter and around this game. It's really a group of wonderful people, and you know, it's awesome. And this is the reason why we make games. And so we genuinely always want to thank people when we get a chance. And you guys are the best. Thank you so much. Thanks for coming out to have this meetup. And hopefully you guys got to see each other and put names to faces. And hopefully you guys are part of the Brimstone community group on Facebook. And we just really appreciate all of your support through the Kickstarters and the community group and the, you know, all of it. So thank you.
Yep. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you guys for putting this on. It's great.
Yes. Thank you. You guys are amazing.
Yeah, thank you.
So once again, thank you guys so much for joining us, and we'll see you guys soon.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, guys.
Bye. All right. Stay safe, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.